No more show at late night, nothing but illustrious, yes.
That's right, you trash bags. Tonight we have...
straight from the BX, you know, in the building.
That's right, BX all day.
What it is.
You know what I mean? Our next guest has been committed to public service since 97, B. That's when the best hip-hop came out. Mm-hmm. And is currently in his third term as the Bronx Borough President. Give it up one time for Ruben Diaz Jr.
Gentlemen, how are you?
How are you, sir?
Thank you for having me on.
Oh, man. This is like watching BX12 in real life. Like, oh, wow.
You're chilling, bro.
Really here.
Pleasure to be here, man.
All right.
Thank you for congratulations.
Coming, thank you for
success.
Coming all the way from the Bronx here.
BX.
Yes, BX. Man. What's it like to be the leader of the BX?
It's the best job in the world, man. Mm-hmm. I'm the president of my hometown.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Birthplace of hip hop, home of the Yankees, El Condado de la Salsa.
La Salsa.
You're actually a resident of the Bronx.
All my life.
All your life. Yeah. Were you born in Puerto Rico?
No, my parents
your
were.
Your parents were born?
Yeah, my grandmother came here when my mother was a young girl, mm-hmm, to the Washington Heights. My father came after the army to Brooklyn. They met working in factories down on 26th Street.
Mm-hmm.
And as they started to get together and falling in love, they settled in the Bronx. My brother, sister, and I were all born in the Bronx.
What part?
Boogie Down Bronx, South Bronx.
South Bronx? Ah.
So I was born in more houses.
Okay.
Public housing.
Hey. DJ's in the house.
149th Street.
Mm. You heard?
Oh, man. What was it like growing up in the Bronx?
You know, it's...
This is a nationwide program, so we like to tell people from the Bronx, like, yo, explain it to the world. Like, what is, it's different.
It's different.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bronx is different today than it was when I was growing up, obviously.
Right.
But it's amazing because when you look at the negative stereotypes and the images of the Bronx in the 70s and the 80s, and by the way, we had a lot of challenges, mm-hmm, it was still some of the best time of my life.
It was fun,
yeah. Right? Yeah, I mean, obviously you had crime, you had urban decay.
A lot of arson
and things like that. But, you know, growing up on the block with the fellas, playing skelzies and slugs, uh-huh, and brown pole to brown pole football and pitching in sponge ball. Those are the best times of my life. You know, so.
And there's like a sense of, and it's a biggest, I feel like there's a bigger sense of community, man, in the Bronx than there is in like other places, bro.
Yeah, I mean, we talk differently.
Yeah.
We walk differently.
There's
a certain DNA when you come from the Bronx, mm-hmm, and even though, unlike Brooklyn and Queens, we don't really identify ourselves with the different neighborhoods.
Right.
Either from the South Bronx or I'm from around Fordham. Even though there's 62 neighborhoods.
Kingsbridge. Yeah,
I'm from Kingsbridge or from the West or the North, like that. The Valley. But everyone basically knows each other.
All right, so here's an Instagram video you posted the other day.
Yeah.
That lets us know you're an old school Bronx.
You real.
Okay.
You real for this.
Let me see. Oh, this is playing slugs here.
Yeah. On the side of the building.
There you go.
I sliced that. I cut Vic.
That's why they got the signs up in front of it that says no ball playing.
You have to know how to hit the ball. Now, watch this. Watch this. I'm going to put it through the legs, though. There you go.
Ooh.
Did you see that?
On the block.
A little
Scott probably passed by. Like, hey, get off the car. Sorry, sir. Sorry.
I'll tell you two things. Never challenge a Puerto Rican in slugs or handball. You will lose.
Especially basketball, man. Come on.
Yo, listen, if you come up on the handball court and there's a Puerto Rican dude, like an old poppy
with
type,
the glove?
With the fingerless gloves?
With the coals?
He's washing
you. Challenge him.
He's washing you.
You know what's amazing? He won't even move. Right?
He won't move.
One spot. He's got you running all over the place.
All over the place, yeah.
Don't go to the handball court or Orchard Beach. That's like the final level.
That's like the ultimate.
There's a guy that hasn't lost on there from like 1959.
Exactly.
Standing there.
Julio's just waiting for you.
What was the Bronx like in hip hop's early days?
I remember, BX is the birthplace of hip-hop.
Mm-hmm, hip-hop.
I remember growing up and going to the community center,
mm-hmm,
in Bronx River, mm-hmm, Zulu Nation. I'm from the Soundview section of the Bronx, mm-hmm, and it's known as Sonia Sotomayor houses now, but back then it was Bronxdale houses.
Yeah.
And we had Disco King Mario,
mm-hmm,
and on Rosedale Park, the jams were out there. And I remember being a little shorty, going out there with my brother and the guys from the block, and mm-hmm, seeing them DJ and people breakdancing and boogieing. Those were the fun days as well. You had the house parties and people battled, and it was just a different place, a different way of when you speak of hip hop than it is today.
Mm-hmm. What's the biggest misconception people have of the Bronx that you come across?
Well, today, the biggest misconception is that the Bronx is still burned down, that, mm-hmm, the Bronx, I mean, if you look, to get a little serious here, in the last 9 years since I've been the borough president, we've seen a turnaround. 84 million square feet of economic development.
Mm-hmm.
$15.5 billion private dollars invested in our borough, 40,000 new units of housing. We had tourism up by 14%, and it's safer than it's been since 1951. So it's incredible because you still get these tours. People want to come in and they want to see the burnt down Bronx, and they actually get disappointed when they don't see burnt down buildings. Now, I'm not saying, fellas, I'm not saying that life is perfect.
Right.
But the biggest misconception is that we are still the Bronx of the 70s, the 80s, and the early 90s.
Right. What's going on with gentrification in the South Bronx? Is that like a rising threat, something to watch out for? Is it a good thing, bad thing? How do you feel about it?
Because I always felt like it was not gonna happen ever because of like the inaccessibility to like the Tony parts of like Manhattan and like, you know what I mean?
So gentrification and displacement is something that weighs on me every day, right? Mm-hmm. And it depends. I mean, you see it in different parts of the city. It's not always bad being, you know, last. So when you look at development, the Bronx is the last place that developers looked at, but it was give us the opportunity to study, to look at what works in other boroughs and what you can do differently. Mm-hmm. And a lot of folks get nervous at change, but I have to tell you, more now than ever, there are folks from the Bronx who have done well, like my sons. My sons are both two college graduates. Mm-hmm. Hilda and I have been together 29 years. We have two young men in their mid-20s, and they're college graduates. And unlike when we were growing up, the young professional Bronxite, the minority Bronxite, is not taught to break out, to leave.
Right.
Back then, it was like, you made it and get out.
Wow,
they want to stay. So we have to make a space for them. And a lot of times, I mean, when you look at the public parks and green spaces, we've done over $400 million worth in the last 10 years of repairing and renewing our green spaces. And there's some folks who say, oh, when you do that, it's for somebody else. No. We want to fix up Orchard Beach. We raised $70 million for the pavilion. Mm-hmm. Some folks will say, oh, you're doing that gentrification, that's for somebody else. No, it's for you, for the Bronxite. You deserve it. And so that's what we're working on, where you can have better things, you can have more amenities, and it doesn't necessarily have to be for other people. It could be for you, because for too many years we haven't had that, right? Will there be other folks coming to the Bronx? Absolutely. And it's always been that way, and that's the nature of the city. Mm-hmm. But we also have to make sure that there's a place for those who have traditionally been there and those who have seen upward mobility in terms of their finances but don't want to leave.
Right.
How do we keep them there?
All right. You're a humble guy. You don't have to be humble on this question.
Okay.
Are you solely responsible for the Yankees being so hot this season?
All me. I went in there right away last year. Said, something has to change. My man Judge, Judge needs some help.
We
brought in some talent here. Mm-hmm. And then I went and gave the guys a pep talk, and look at how they've been hitting home runs.
Look at Torres.
Even though Judge struck out like 8 times yesterday.
We'll take it. It's all good. There's ups and downs.
But it's all me, yeah.
It's all you. Take credit for that.
Just you and Derek Jeter.
What are your three favorite Yankee teams? Because you're a lifelong Yankee fan.
So I grew up with the Yankees in the 70s and the 80s. Mm-hmm. Look, when I was growing up, I wanted to be like Greg Nettles.
Okay.
I don't want to age myself here.
Right.
But I remember Greg Nettles, for the viewers who don't know, he was an ultimate third baseman. Back then, you had Greg Nettles and I believe it was Ron Say. Was it Ron Say? Who was it? There was Mike Schmidt. Mm. And Greg Nettles used to be the one to die whenever you try to burn his line. Mm-hmm. So growing up, when I was a sandslot kid playing in Blessed Sacrament or in Rosedale Park, I would dare you to burn my line.
Right.
So I play off the third base line so I could die for a scrape my elbows and gun you out at first base, you know? But, the teams with Reggie Jackson, Bob Watson. Obviously, when Derek Jeter, that whole era is something the core four. And I've become personal friends with Bernie Williams. I've become personal friends with Mariano. So, those have been my best teams.
He plays a mean guitar, right?
Mariano, yeah. And Bernie does. Mariano is now going into development. So, and we've been doing a lot of great work with some of our kids and A-Rod.
Mm.
So A-Rod has this whole program now where he is teaching our young folks how to identify property and how to purchase property and develop it. And so we've been doing a lot of work with him as well.
You think he's just trying to impress J-Lo? Or?
He doesn't have to anymore.
Yeah, he bagged it. All right. We got the Puerto Rican Day Parade coming up this weekend.
Right.
But there's kind of like a somber tone over it because of the hurricane. You actually wrote a piece in today's Daily News talking about what do you have planned for the parade?
So I think with our contingency, first of all, back up a little bit. People have to know that this government, mm-hmm. this president, Trump and Congress have totally turned their backs on Puerto Ricans,
oh, yeah.
who are 3.5 million Americans, right? Mm-hmm. And they knew that when Maria was coming, that it was going to be a big hurricane that was going to devastate the island, and they didn't prepare correctly.
Right.
Subsequent to that, they brought in folks from the military, and we appreciate that, but there hasn't been any real resources. The billions of dollars that is needed, the financial resources for the infrastructure, for the electric grid and other things, the same way they've taken care of Texas and Florida is the same thing that they should be doing for Puerto Rico. Right. And they haven't done that. And I think that this is the worst case of either ineptitude and stupidity by a government or the most egregious example of intentional governmental malpractice mm-hmm. where they just don't want to help out, right?
Right.
And it's sad, and there was a Harvard study that was shown that from the day of the hurricane to December 31st of last year, there were 4,645 people who died as a result of that because they didn't have any equipment and electricity in the hospitals, doctors, medicine, and so on and so forth.
Basics, though.
Our people are dying, and the Puerto Rican Day Parade, the National Puerto Rican Day Parade, which you said it is next Sunday, mm-hmm. is the 60th anniversary, and we always celebrate, mm-hmm. we dance, and we should, and we celebrate who we are as a people in our culture. But I challenge my Puerto Rican brethren to be defiant, to express outrage. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna do it with our contingency, with T-shirts and a banner, and everybody has a right to express themselves at the way they're gonna express, but we just can't go through the normal exercise
routine, yeah.
of waving the flag and pretending like our families aren't dying. They are. So hopefully if you're Puerto Rican and if you're not. By the way, one of the things that impresses me, shout out to Fat Joe, my man.
Shout out to Joey
And Jay-Z and Roc Nation who pay for a lot of the airplanes to send that where we collected items and we sent out to Puerto Rico. But one of the things that really warms my heart is that Dominicans and other Caribbean, Jamaicans and whites and blacks and everybody came together for the people of our island. We only hope, we only pray, and we continue to push that the federal government does the same.
Mm. Should you be the next mayor of New York?
I think so.
I'm moving.
Yeah, hopefully New Yorkers will think so.
You know what I'm saying?
I've been elected now 23 years of my life.
Mm-hmm.
I will be 48 years old. In 2021, I'm 45 now, and I would have been at that time like the 26 years of my life, and I'm term limited as the borough president. I think that we have a strong personal narrative. We work to turn one, if not the most challenging part of the city around, mm-hmm. and I hope to take that message out to New Yorkers. And if I'm gonna stay in government, I think mayor of the city of New York is the only position that I would be interested in pursuing.
Ooh.
I mean, yo, bro, because the last three mayors have been completely swaggerless. Like, we need some.
We need that.
Yeah, we need some swag as in the mayor office.
And how do we have mayors who are like Boston Red Sox?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, come on, bro. Eating pizza with a fork.
Eating it backwards.
Come on, my guy.
It's a borrow.
You don't even know what a Frio Frio is.
You don't know what slugs is.
Come on, my guy.
You never been to a street ball tournament?
You know what I'm saying? You never played Cena in your life?
Yeah, you never been to Skelzy?
Come on, man.
4, 5, 6
head crack. Do you have a favorite spot on City Island?
In City. So I'm allergic to shellfish,
but I go
to like to Tony's, and I go to all of those.
I should have met the Seafood City fight. Like, I was like, is the Bronx Bomb trying to
get over the chair? Damn, that chair hit him hard.
Oh man, that's not funny. Yeah, Seafood City. My wife likes the crab shanty, the king crab.
Oh
next
yeah,
she likes that.
Cow crab shanty.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, shout out City Island.
So Riverdale, does it bother you that sometimes people from Riverdale, not all people, try to act as if they're not part of the Bronx?
It does, and you know what? For many years they did that, but we've been fixing the Bronx. So more and more of them are starting to own up.
Claim up it.
Their river. So how many times I go now when the Bronx is we're receiving all these accolades and recognition and all these write-ups, folks have come up to me now and says, you're my borough president. I say, oh yeah, where do you live? I live in Riverdale. And I say, yeah, that's the Bronx.
Yeah, yeah.
That's good. Yeah. So it's commencement season. Are you giving any addresses?
Today, as a matter of fact, I just came from LaGuardia Community College. Shout out LaGuardia. That's my alma mater.
Oh, wow.
I was there with Sean King.
Sean King.
Shout out to him as well. He did well today. Mm-hmm. We both spoke at the commencement. So yeah, this is the season and mm-hmm. we always go around. And I was pleased to go back to LaGuardia, where I did not get a chance to walk.
Really?
When I graduated in 98. So it took me 13 years to get 2 degrees from CUNY. I'm what you call a CUNY twofer.
Oh.
So it's LaGuardia Lehman. But I was also a young father, a young husband. I was a young assembly member.
Right, right.
I got elected in 1996. You guys previously had Adriano Espaillat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He and I got elected the same year.
Adriano.
Right? So I wasn't able because I was in Albany. But yeah, this is the season. Congratulations to the class of 2018 to all graduates.
You know what I'm saying?
What's the secret to a good commencement speech?
Whoa. I don't know if I do that, but I know when I've been, by the way, my youngest son graduated from Temple mm-hmm. 2 weeks ago, and Cory Booker was the commencement keynote. The thing is to tell a little bit about your personal narrative, your story, and then also challenge the graduating class to doing more, to think of more than just themselves as individuals, or to think more of just this day. Mm. Like, what are you gonna do with this? So if you can be funny, if you can tell a story either of yourself or of somebody that you know that people can relate to, and then bring it home and wrap it up in a nice bow where you challenge the graduating class, I think you're on the money. And not to be too long.
Okay.
Word, yeah, don't run long, B. Don't wait until they start playing music and then, you know what I'm saying, you gotta get on stage and all of that.
Is the Bronx ever gonna get City Bike?
I hope so. If not, we're gonna try to do some
our
other.
Our own bike?
Yeah, BX bike?
BX bikes? Bikes with pegs?
BMX bikes, you know what I mean?
That could be good for the community.
Is it an Uber, Ruber? You know what I'm saying? You just pull up on a BMX.
Maybe I start my own company, right?
Listen, we can run it.
But it's unfair because us and Staten Island, we're the only boroughs. They call it mm-hmm. City Bike, but
it's
they're not.
City
Bike? They give it to Jersey City. They didn't give it
they
to
They got
Bronx.
In a Hoboken. Like, come on, man.
Yeah, so we need that. And more and more Bronxites are riding bikes. In fact, every year we have the Tour de Bronx,
mm-hmm.
the largest free cycling event in the state. You guys is in October.
You already know.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, I'm coming through. Yeah.
I'm starting to see more bike lanes in the Bronx.
I'll be on the pegs.
Turn it up.
What inspired you to get into public service? Is it a family tradition, or is it something that like you saw your pops doing and you were like, yo, I want to do that? Or was it like,
bro,
I wanted to be.
No, he didn't say that to me, but my father did introduce me. But I wanted to be like a rapper or a New York Nick. Basketball, hip hop. And I was introduced to politics at the tender age of 7, putting up posters when my father first ran. Fast forward, he lost a couple of times. And then in 1994, I became what's called a district leader, mm-hmm. which is a party position. In 96, I ran for my first office, and then I won. And my father, who is also a councilman now, he got elected 5 years after me. So even though he's the senior, I am the senior elected official in the family. But my sister's a retired NYPD sergeant. My mm-hmm. brother is a supervisor at the New York City Housing Authority. My mother's a retired daycare teacher. And so we all were taught to give back. And we were brought up with the civic mindedness. And I just felt that the best way for me to do it at the time was to be a voice for the youth in government and in politics. So basically
you got at a higher rank than Papi.
Yeah, he better respect me.
You know what I'm saying? I chilled before you get the chancletazo, you better chill.
Mm. All right. No, the chancletazo was mommy. Y todavía me mete cocotazo.
All right, we have a video of you rapping with Dougie Fresh and Slick Rick.
Yo! TBT. See, this is what we need as a mayor. Stop playing.
This is crazy right here.
We love to party. We don't cause trouble. We don't bother nobody. just some that's on the mic. And when we rock them on the mic, we rock the mic, right?
So let me tell you about these events we do at Mashuda Parkway, and this is the ending of Bronx Week. And shout out to Slick Rick, who was not there. I did Slick Rick because we only had Dougie. Slick Rick wasn't there, but this year we inducted Slick Rick to the Bronx Walk of Fame. Yeah. And when we do this, we bring in all these guys. I mean, I've been up there, I rapped with Rakim and KRS-One and the Brand Nubians. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it's me living my childhood dreams.
Ruben Diaz Jr., what would you like your rainbow to say?
I would like, so we've been talking about the Bronx and it's the birthplace of hip hop, and hip hop is now the largest, biggest genre of music, right? Mm-hmm. But if it wasn't for the Bronx.
Raps probably would never be yours. So,
tell me where you from.
Uptown, baby.
You know what it is. Give it up for Ruben Diaz Jr.
Word up.
One day, you know what it is.
You know, one day.
You're watching the Desus and Mero YouTube channel, stupid.
Click to watch more videos and clips.
Subscribe, please.
Click and comment.